Constraints are one of my favorite features in Revit. They allow you to make your models smart by keeping relations between elements in the event of change. In this video, we will be learning how to set those constraints up for rebar in Revit, making some smart Revit rebar. Let's go. Now, I'm personally not a rebar expert. I'm an architect, I'm not a structural engineer. However, my good friend and colleague Andrei has made an ebook exactly on the topic of reinforced concrete structures in Revit, and rebar is obviously a big part of that ebook. Now, I will be showing you a chapter from that ebook, and I'm just going to be showing that inside of Revit in this video. However, if you would like to check out that ebook, I'm going to be leaving a link up in the cards above and down in the description of this video. It is available on balkanarchitect.com, and also just to mention, he also has a full template on offer, also available on balkanarchitect.com. Okay, so now without any further ado, let's jump straight into Revit. And here we are in Revit. So here, as you can see, we have just a simple column, and then we have a stirrup. This is what that looks like in 3D. So when you place any rebar inside of any concrete element in Revit, what you're going to notice is when you select that rebar, here under constraints, we have the edit constraints button. And when I click on that, it's going to go into this green edit mode. And one of these is going to light up. So it's basically highlighting one of the existing sides of our rebar. Now, if you hit the space key, you can basically toggle around. So these are the rebar sides. This little one is just the start of the rebar. So you can just kind of toggle around, or if you hold shift and then hit the space key, it's going to toggle back. You can also highlight each one of these and then just select them. So it's going to do the same thing. Now, what you'll notice here is that we get this little icon. So basically, this is telling us that our rebar is going to be adjacent to the rebar cover, and the distance is currently zero. So it's basically all the way up to that rebar cover. Now, if I click here, as you can see, this looks like a little rebar cover. Now, if I click, as you can see, it's going to turn into a full line, indicating that now it's measuring from the edge of this column to the center of rebar, and the value is 25 millimeters. Now, depending on which one of these you leave it at, and then of course you can add the numbers. So if I type in minus 30, it's going to move it in. If I go back to 25, oops, I had to go with minus 25. It going to broaden it out, which I don't want. So let's just add minus here, hit enter. There we go. So at any one of these that you leave it at, it's going to save that. So when you make any changes to the column, it's going to use that. So you might think, well, what's the point of it? Well, let's say you change the rebar cover. Do you still want the rebar to follow that rebar cover, or do you want it to follow the outside face of that column? Depending on that, you're going to pick any which one of these. And then of course, even if it's set like this to the rebar cover, you can still add a value. So I can type in minus 10, bring it in if I want to change the position of this rebar. Now, in this case, I just want to bring it down to zero. And then if you're happy with what you've set up, you can always click here to finish. Now, what happens when we add some vertical lines running through this column? Well, when I select this and then go here to constraints, go to edit constraints, what you'll notice here is that if I hit the space key, I can toggle between these three options. Now, for each of these, when it's highlighted, so here we have kind of the horizontal axis for these three bars. If I click on this bar here, now I can actually edit the relationship between these vertical bars and the horizontal stirrup. So what you'll notice here is that we have this little button that says toggle rebar clearance distance. So we can either measure from the exterior side of both bars or from the center lines of both bars. So you see how the numbers change. Here, it basically, when we selected the stirrup, it brought the vertical bars up to that stirrup side, and then the number here went to zero because obviously they're now touching. Now, if we switch this to center, so the kind of the centers of each one, now we have a numerical value of minus 11. So in both cases, you can edit this. So if I want to change this to minus 15, I can. So it moves it out a little bit like that. Or I can just switch it to this, and then we have a different value, in this case minus 3, so I can make that larger, go to minus 5. So if you can't see the number like I can't here, you just click on it and then you can see the value. And then we can do the same thing on these sides. So if I select this side, as you can see, in this case it's actually measuring all the way from the face of the column. Now I can switch this, so I can go to rebar cover, or I can just click here on this rebar, so it's now attaching it to the to this edge here, or this side here of the stirrup. So now again I can click here and toggle distance between the edges of both bars, or do I want to measure from centers of both bars? So those are the two options. And then again, I can add a numerical value. So here, if I go with minus 5, it's going to go in by that value. Again, this is really important. You want to set this up so in the future, when you change the size of the column, you want to make sure that the rebar kind of stays exactly how it should and nothing kind of gets displaced, because you don't want to have to manually adjust rebar anytime the architect decides to make a change in the project. Now let's talk another constraint that we have, and that's for cases where we have rebar that stops at a certain point and then it picks up at another point or something like that. Now this is kind of an unusual example, but I think it's useful just to demonstrate how the rebar constraint works. So if I open up this section, you can see I have bars going up here, and then I have some bars here. And let's say we want to control the distance from here to here. So how would we do that? Well, we would select a set of bars here, then go to constraints, edit constraint, and then what I would do, you can see that here, if we select this, it's being controlled by the cover, so it's picking up a cover, that this one here, so I don't want that. So what you can do now, while this constraint is selected, I can click here on these bars, and now it's going to switch to that. And as you can see, the distance here is minus 475, so I can round it up. So let's go with minus 500, just like that. But then you're going to notice that we have this little icon here. So when it shows two arrows, that means that both the bottom rebar will control the top one and the top one will control the bottom one. And when it's just one arrow, that means that the top rebar will control the bottom one, but the bottom one will not control the top one. So let me demonstrate. Here it's now set to only one arrow, meaning that this rebar here, as we move it, it will move the bottom one, but the bottom one won't affect the top one. So if I hit finish, and then if I select this rebar here, these bars, move them down, you can see these move down with that. If I move these up, yeah, it's going to follow. However, if I select this set and move it around, nothing happens to the top ones. So if I now keep the lower set selected, go to constraints, edit constraint, I can select this. Obviously we changed the number, so let's go back to minus 500. And then if I just click on this again, so it's going to be constrained both ways. Now when I hit finish, you'll notice that if we move this one, the bottom one still moves, but if we move the bottom one, the top one will now move with it. So basically that's the difference between those two toggling options. And finally, I would like to show you how all of this works. So when we have, in this example, two sets of stirrups, how we can attach those. So for example, here we have these, and you can see they're kind of overlapping here, and I just would like to have a bit more control over them. So what I'll do is I'll select this set and drop it down a little bit. And then while it's still selected, I can go here to constraints, go to edit constraints. And here, as you can see, I can select the top face here, top plane. And now I can change its constraints. So I can attach it to this one. And as you can see, it's going to give me all of the same options as I had previously. So for example, I want to have them just kind of measuring from the edges, or do we want to switch to measure from centers, and then this is the value from edges. It's zero, so I can raise that to, I don't know, like 20 millimeters, or actually let's go with minus 20 millimeters, just like that. Now I can also make sure that this is a two-way constraint. So now what that means is if I hit finish, orbit around, and now when I move this one, both of these will move because while we have connected them, and they're also always going to stay at this offset here on top, which we have assigned, which is kind of cool. So there we go. That's how constraints work when it comes to Rebar and Revit. Well, those are the basics at least. That's just part of this particular chapter on constraints in the reinforcement ebook. So as I said, if you want to check it out, I'm going to be including a link up in the cards above and then also down in the description of this video. And when you go to buy it at the checkout page, you can get the template, the reinforced concrete template as well at a discount. So if you want that, that's a great way to get both the ebook and the template at once at a discount. Thank you for watching, guys. Make sure to check out my website, balkanarchitect.com, for more Revit courses. There I have over 120 hours of content, and I'm adding more each week. Make sure to subscribe for more videos, and also I've added a video over there that might interest you as well.